A couple of months ago, I started working on my new project, Solar Rogue, and I decided to go with a new architecture, something I hadn't done before, a kind of simplified version of the ECS system entity component. But software architecture have this funny little characteristic that they always start as a perfect gem, and then as code gets more and more complex and things start piling up on top of each other, it usually becomes a stinking pile of... well, you get the idea. So how is Solar Rogue performing after maybe, 8,000 line of codes or something? Well, let's dig in and I'll show you what I got. I already did a pretty in-depth videos of how I did the ECS and how I see it in Godot, so I'm not gonna go into too much detail right now, but just as a refresher, here's what I have in my game. So basically, I have this node that I called behavior that is kind of a container for all these systems in my game. And in my case, I'm using behavior and system interchangeably. I mean, for me, it means the same thing. So if you hear me saying one or the other, it just means the same thing, behavior system. So for example, I have these things, the player system, the AI system, the damage system, and all these systems. And then a little bit at the bottom, I created a canvas layer that holds all the UI elements. And the reason it's inside a canvas layer is that this way it's not affected by any transformation I put over everything else. It's in its separate layer, so it's a separate render only in the screen cords in it. And I have all my windows, all my dialogues, and their visibility is being controlled by one of the system that I call the UI manager. But individually, all of these windows and dialogue handle everything themselves. I don't have systems for handling every single windows. I thought this was kind of overkill. Inside a single window, things are a little bit more traditional, if you could say. They just get fed from the system all the data they need to display themselves, and then they just manage all of their events and data and display and all of this inside each of their individual components. So as you can see, I've got a bunch of script attached to each of my lists item and each of my containers so that they can manage the display and the visibility of each item inside this single individual UI. Back in my main scene, since pretty much everything in my game is procedurally generated, I don't have that much other stuff beside the behavior and the HUD. Everything else I have in my scene is basically just placeholder for what I'm gonna load dynamically later on. And the reason I have a few of these placeholders is because they allow me to kind of group things together so that when I need to clean up later on, I can just delete everything under that node. I believe the way in Godot you're supposed to do that is using groups like this here. But I found every time I tried to use groups, I could do it better and more simply with just using nodes and node hierarchy. So I've been sticking with using nodes and node hierarchy whenever I need to organize and delete or manage my nodes that I create dynamically, and it's been working pretty well so far. To avoid as much as possible coupling between my behaviors, I tried to rely really heavily on global events, and to do that, in my project setting, I have an autoload that I called behavior events. And this autoload is basically just a list of events, and I have a long list of events, and it's been really awesome so far. Yes, they are globals, and you should always avoid globals, but events have this particularity that no one cares who's listening or who's not. So even though a lot of my behaviors are coupled with these events, it doesn't really matter if I rip out a behavior and then the event is just not fired anymore, no one's gonna care. And even if there was someone listening to this event, but now because of some change in my code, no one is listening to it, my behavior can still fire this event and no one's gonna care that no one is listening. So in that way, the behaviors are completely separate. The system talk to each other, but without really having any impact, I can just remove a system and it just doesn't matter to any of the other systems. One of the things I was worried about when I was going to start having a lot of events when I started this project was that it would become eventually a mess having like all those events in the same place and no one knows who's firing what. But Actually, it's been really good right now. I haven't had any problems and I just keep adding more events. And as long as I keep the names very clear, it's really obvious what's happening and I don't have any problems really with having global events like that. So I would highly recommend that you do that if you ever want something like that in your game. So behaviors, events, and UI elements. The next thing is the entities, which are contained inside this object scene that I have. That is just a really simple Node2D that allows me to position my objects and a simple script attached to it that is basically just container for JSON data. And the JSON itself is what constitutes my component. So as you can see here, I have this JSON data, and all of these are technically components. Some of them are a little bit more complicated and have attributes in them. And I use this for my systems to decide what to do with each of the objects I have in my game. But as you can see, the attribute script, instead of having just components in the form of JSON data, I've had to add a couple of methods to it. One of the things I did is that I created a pattern for accessing my JSON data. Because, like, for example, if I wanted to access, let's say, the list of weapons in my mounts, then I had to do all the time something like if mounts in object and weapons in object.mounts and object.mounts.weapons.size bigger than 0, and then I could do whatever I wanted to do. But this is really painful. So what I decided to do instead is I created some kind of a language that I can use to query my JSON data. So I can now do something like if object.getAttribute, and then I do some like weapons.mounts. And this way, I don't need to check all of this. It's all handled by the method getAttribute, which has simplified my code tremendously. But if you keep going down a little bit, you'll notice that there's some weird methods appearing in the attribute, like initCargo or initMounts or something like getMaxShield. And really, that shouldn't belong into any entity. But the problem I have with having events everywhere is that you cannot return values from an event. So that means that whenever I need to query something, whenever I need to do some calculation on my data, then I either have to copy-paste this calculation everywhere in my code, or I need some kind of common reference where to put my method that will calculate whatever I need to calculate, like the maximum shield you can have. And I haven't found a good way of doing it, so I've been putting these methods a little bit everywhere, or sometimes I've been just duplicating it. I have like some methods that I've copy-pasted maybe 3 times in 3 different places just because I couldn't figure out a good place to put them where everyone had access to it. And yeah, that should give you an idea of how much I hate singletons or reference. I really want to decouple my stuff to the point where I'm going to use copy-paste 3 times instead of finding a place to put it. But when I got to like the fourth or fifth time with the get max shield, then I thought, well, okay, I have to put it somewhere that I can access it everywhere. And the only place I could think of was inside the entity or the object. It's not the best place, but I mean, I wasted a lot of time trying to think about ways to avoid this. So I've managed to not have too many of these exceptions, but it's still kind of a little bit of an ugly side of the code that's been growing slowly and surely. This little issue of where to put the methods I don't know how to share with other behaviors or other systems kind of led me to the only other autoload that I'm kind of not proud of. It's called the global autoload, and just from the name, you can tell that it's probably not a good singleton. And yes, indeed, it's just a place where I put everything I couldn't figure a way to make into a good object or a good design pattern. I did try really hard every time I was thinking of putting something here to try to find another way, but some of the stuff, there just was no way around it. So some of these are not too bad, like I've put some global enums that are used by different systems so they can be accessed from all the systems. And then I have some copy-pasted that data that are just a little bit different for getting JSON information out of objects that are not entity, because I have some of those. So it's basically copy-paste from the entity, but with a few variation because it comes from directly JSON and not an entity itself. So that's also a little bit ugly. And then it's just a few utility methods, like this methods to clean the paths I'm using when I'm loading JSON or loading sprites or scenes and stuff like that. This way I make sure they're always the same, which allow me in turn to sometimes do comparison. So I can do if the path for this thing is the same as the path for this other thing, because sometimes I had paths that had res, sometimes I had paths that had users, sometimes I had paths that had nothing, and then the comparison would fail just because of this little difference. And also, I've had issues before in other projects where there was issues with uppercase and lowercase and stuff like that, because on Windows system it doesn't matter, but on Unix and Linux it can have an impact on your file system. So, you know, it's another place where I can just, for example, do a lowercase all, so when I want to compare a file name or something like that, I know that it's a standardized file name and that I'm not missing my comparison for stupid reasons. There's also one system that I had to put in a singleton, and that's the level loader. And I decided to keep just a reference to it in my global autoload, which means it doesn't even have to be loaded, but once it's loaded, it's going to set itself in the globals so that everyone can access it. And the reason for that is that the level loader is the one responsible for loading all my objects in my game and managing all the objects in the world, so it knows the position of all the object, it knows how to instantiate them, how to load them, and these are a lot of the methods that I need them to return some values, so I cannot have them as an event. Most of my systems, when they request an object from the level loader, they're asking for the object back because they want to do something with it. So the level loader cannot use an event. Otherwise, the system requesting the object wouldn't get a reference back. It could do it with some sort of callback, so like request the object with an event, and then when you get the object, call me back with this. And it could work, but it seemed to me like it was a little bit too much of an over-design. So, and because it creates some issues. I had to use this pattern in some stuff that were asynchronous. So let me give you an example. In my scene, I have this UI that I call the how many dialogue. And it's basically just a window to ask how many objects you want to drop, or how many objects you want to pick up, or how many objects you want to use for crafting and stuff like that. But it comes back a lot in a lot of different menus. So I had to create a way to access it. But since it's asynchronous, the values it return is going to take some time. I'm not going to get it in the same frame until the player has chosen and clicked the OK button. So the way I did it is that, for example, in my transfer inventory dialog, when you try to drop an object or you try to transfer something, and I have to ask you how many, instead of doing it right away, like for example here, where I just remove the item and add it in the new ship, I have to back up everything I'm doing right now in a class variable, then do the event that will pop the how many dialog and register some kind of callback method. And when this callback method gets called on my UI, then it's going to use the backed up variables to finish what it was working on using the value it got from the dialog. But I just can't imagine doing that for every single thing in my game that needs a callback. So that's why I sacrificed my beautiful design pattern to have one reference to the level loader, which is kind of like the world manager in my game. And this level loader has all the methods that needs to return values. So like get data from tile, get ship, request ship, unload ship, and all these kind of things that, you know, you usually want to call directly and not through an event or something like that. And if you're thinking, dude, that guy is crazy about how much he doesn't want any coupling in his code, well, you are partially right, but let me give you an example of something that worked just so flawlessly that I had trouble to believe it. Look at my main menu. So this thing is the first thing you see when you start the game, and I didn't want it to be heavy or have all the systems or anything like that. I wanted it to be as lightweight as possible. So I just ripped out all the behaviors in my game, nothing except the UI manager, because there's a couple of windows I have to pop in and out, ask the player name, settings, options, and stuff like that. So I just took this behavior from my main scene. It's the same thing here. It's the same behavior, the UI manager, and I popped it in there without any modification, and it just started doing its thing. It used the events, and yes, I have all the other events for creating players, loading sprites, and all this kind of stuff. I don't need that. I don't call them. They don't cost anything. But the push and pop UI events, and the one managing the visibility and passing the JSON data for the UI stuff, that's all handled in the UI manager. And I just dropped it in my main scene, and it worked without any issues whatsoever. I was pretty happy with it. So one of the reasons I think my game has been working so well with the ECS the way it is right now and with events and all that is because my game is basically turn-based. So it means that it's always more efficient for me to wait until some event happen instead of just doing it the way an ECS system would normally work, which is having the system running in a constant loop and iterating over all the nodes, and then ideally being in its own thread. I don't need to do that because it's always more efficient for me to wait till there's an event and then process the node that is affected by these events. But it also makes it, I think, much more simple for me. I didn't have to deal with like loops and threads and these kind of things and registering my nodes to each system and stuff like that. I just had to put some global events and everything was working so fine. So this is a caveat. If you don't have a turn-based system, it might be a little bit more complicated than what I just showed you. So there you have it. I seriously thought things would get much worse than this. It's been pretty good so far. It's not that there hasn't been some hiccups. There's some things that are a little bit more troublesome, like the return values, how to get that. And of course, debugging with a lot of events is always a little bit painful. I mean, you don't know who's calling who, you don't know who's triggering the event, and when you break, usually it's too late, and sometimes an event will be triggered, but multiple systems are listening to it, so you can't tell which system is going to get the event first, so you have to deal with that a little bit. But all in all, I find it pretty awesome, and yeah, I'll take composition over inheritance any time of the day. So what about you guys? Are you working on some project right now? Are you using this kind of ECS system? Has it been treating you well? Do you have some issues with your events? How have you been dealing with that? Just write some comments in the comment section about it, or come see me on my Discord channel and we can have a chat if you want. And also don't forget to subscribe, like the video and all this stuff. And if you want to check, I also have a Patreon page. I appreciate any kind of support you guys can give me. It really helps. And if you enjoy the content, then see you guys in my next episode. Bye!